Ubi akin di, wo akun. Na bimpo vigion kawen, na gupito amu, na tetuge wingyo mu. Hello and welcome everyone. My name is Aurora Escobedo and I come from the Coral people. And I am from the Pueblo of Tizuki. I am a filmmaker with Little Globe. It is my honor to introduce Presente, Stories of Santa Fe. I am proud and grateful to be a part of this project. This has become my Owinge, my tribe, my home. For me, this is more than just storytelling. It is a chance to take a step back and listen to one another. I tend to get stuck in the mindset of selfishness, and watching this project unfold has taught me selflessness. Presente is by no means an attempt to reflect all of the stories of Santa Fe, nor the diversity of experience. It is an invitation and an offering. Stories bring us one step closer to understanding each other. Each and every one of us is going through something. And when we allow ourselves to be open and tell our story, we allow that voice to be heard, and it may reach someone who is going through something similar to us. After the show, feel free to go to the lobby to visit our project partners who are committed to placing people at the center of the economic and equity-based challenges that face Santa Fe. Thank you and enjoy the evening.
Sisters and his mom who live in the apartment. And I don't entirely know what happened. He ended up not being able to stay where he was.
Coffee.
He had a whole bedroom of things that he owned for a couple years of living there.
You have something to say? You're looking at the world when you look at the camera.
When I was young, I had a certain group of friends that there was like four of us, and we rode bikes everywhere in Santa Fe, and we're invincible because everywhere we were, we belonged. That was where we ran around, and you know, our stomping grounds. It wasn't just our little neighborhood. It was everywhere we went. This was our home. If someone were to ask me, where are you from? I'd like to believe that all of Santa Fe is where I am from. When I was at El Dorado Hotel, I worked in the garage. And the majority of the stories that I would hear of people visiting is how beautiful it is here. It warmed my heart knowing that people are seeking my home. You know, it just kind of like made me feel good about where I'm from. You know, I don't want to keep it for myself, but I don't want to be pushed out of it either.
Ogapoke. White shell water place, ancient and sovereign, now layered and modern. It was and is still her place.
A place of rest for white shell woman. She journeys across the ocean, but turns back when she remembers her children. What were you seeking when you left?
What were you seeking when you arrived?
Perhaps we seek the same things.
Teresa Gabaldon Rios.
Montoya Trujillo.
Gregory Aguilar.
Maria Antonia.
Coltrane Timothy.
Jake Chaston.
Jesus Rios.
Kareem Chisholm.
Cece Rose.
Carolyn Yvette Reddick.
Angelica Rios Baca.
Marisa Inez
Baca.
Massenberg.
Teresa Rios Baca.
Presente!
I have this long history of, well, we've always lived here and we live on this piece of land and you live in a house that your dad built. And the story of you're college educated and you need to move to a larger city to find a job in the field that you're looking for or to meet your professional goals or even to have any, you know, the kind of income that you would need to, I don't know, make something of your art and your life. And so, as I started thinking about this story and as I started thinking about the gaps between what it was like at home and what it was like when I left home, it became clear that for every situation in which I felt safe and secure and normal, there was one in which there was something that pointed to not really belonging. I'm not quite sure where to go or what to do because of the larger story that, like, it's getting expensive to live places and it's hard to find work and I'm overqualified for a lot of jobs and underqualified for a lot of jobs. And then there's the other part of the story, which is that my parents' house is nice and they live on the east side of Santa Fe and my dad built it. It's interesting down here, it's hard to tell if these are like native species or if somebody planted one and they, you know, like it's in a yard somewhere and it kind of transplanted over here. I grew up hearing a lot of nostalgia about, oh, this is what it used to be like. And I think that those stories are really important. I think we need them. But at some point I started noticing that that compulsion in myself, the desire to say, oh, it's never gonna be the way it used to be, came with this underlying sense of hopelessness. And I really wanted to understand what that was about. I wanted to know why we felt hopeless and why we felt like we'd lost something. Why do we feel hopeless that the world is changing around us and we're not changing with it, or we're changing but we're not changing fast enough, or we're changing but in ways we don't want to? Is it a question of allowing it to happen, or is it something that's happening to us?
I was born in Santa Fe, New Mexico on June 22nd, 1966, not far from where my family lived in Hillside at St. Vincent's Hospital. We were always running around trying to make ends meet, never slowing down enough to smell the piñon roasting. We never had enough time, never had enough money.
I was born in central Pennsylvania to immigrant parents who made a home for us in the suburbs. Multiple languages, multiple cultures. Always on the outside looking in, always looking for a place to be comfortable. I was born rootless.
I was born in Santa Fe, in my family home on Camino del Monte Sol, right off Canyon Road. My mamacita, Teresa Gabaldon Rios, comes from generations of Santa Fecinos, Gabaldones, Padillas, Apodacas, Cenas. My daddy, Jesus Rios, was born in the state of Durango, Mexico, and came at the age of 9 to the United States.
My mamá's family was buried by gravel after an earthquake in El Salvador. Not many survived, but my ma did. She ended up raising 8 brown kids in a red state. Oklahoma shaped me as a person, taught me the importance of calloused skin and survival. My mom had to whisper stories about coming to the U.S.
When I was little, I wasn't raised in a conventional sort of way. My earliest memories are waking up in the backseat of a car with a dog as my pillow. And outside the car window was this beautiful field. And every morning was like that. I'd wake up, there's the ocean. I'd wake up, we're in the redwood forest. I'd wake up, we're in some half desert with a mountainscape in the background.
I was born in Harlem Hospital in Harlem, New York. We called it the city within the city.
I was born in Pittsburgh, PA on August 10th, 1981 at West Penn Hospital. I was born where three rivers meet in the Steel City.
I was born in Santa Fe. I haven't really been around the city much. I've been to Zozobra once. I've also been to fiestas. We ate a turkey leg there. We went to Regal Park once too. The swings used to be my favorite, but now the slide is. I may be 15, but I'm still gonna mess around like I'm 12, or maybe 2.
I was born in Santa Fe and grew up between here and Valle de Zaragoza, a small town in Chihuahua, Mexico. Throughout my childhood, we moved back and forth between Mexico and New Mexico. Pero mi pueblo has always felt like my true home. Arriando el ganado, running barefoot, bathing in the river, the smell of manure, el sabor de la leche fresca, the sound of cicadas, and country music. We left Mexico because it was so hard for my family to make a living there.
I'm at Awahopa, Paishkutawatiwa, Tia Mashutani. I am from Kiwa Pueblo, but I was born in Santa Fe. My dad is a microbiologist and my mother is a jeweler. When I was younger, I would beg them to take me to a bookstore after their day's work. It would either be at Borders at San Brusco or Barnes and Noble's on Surios, and sometimes collected works. I'd imagine a book that I wrote on the shelves with a cover that I designed. And Santa Fe has always represented this for me, a door to other worlds. But now I cannot afford to live here.
Esto es un cuento viejo. This is an old story in Santa Fe.
Finally tonight, the sound of moving. That roar you hear in the American Southwest these days is the traffic heading to Santa Fe, New Mexico. The population is up 12% over the past decade there, but many native Hispanics have been displaced in the process. NBC's Roger O'Neill reports tonight on what's becoming the place to live unless you happen to live there already.
In Santa Fe, the neighborhoods are changing as fast as the builders can put up new buildings. There aren't a lot of barrios left. They're all becoming playgrounds for the rich. For the first time since 1600, there are now more Anglos here than there are Hispanics. Lured by the Santa Fe lifestyle, many newcomers are building half-million-dollar haciendas, and some are paying for them with cash.
For a good decade in this town, the growth has been pretty much one-sided, which is catering to the high-end, the very wealthy. And meanwhile, the people who have to live here and make a living here were being neglected.
And being forced to leave their old neighborhoods, unable to pay rising property taxes brought on by all of the new building. While the dramatic change in Santa Fe has disrupted many and perhaps even stripped some of the city's charm away, it has created steady employment and for some a rich opportunity. 95-year-old Jesus Rios has been selling wood from a little lot since 1933.
Three men come and offer me that money, you know, $3 million. I said, well, he told me, Jesus, $3 million is a lot of money. I told him, yes, it's a lot of money, but not enough for this Mexico.
Y que nosotros seamos exactamente como tú, generosos, especialmente con los que tienen necesidad. May we too be as generous as God is with us, especially with those who are in need, who cross our path, and those we know about. May we be generous as He is with us. Amen.
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 Why did you want some of this?
Just half. There we go.
Good. I'll give it to
you. My father always emphasized staying in one place, Santa Fe, because we had the support of each other. And that is still true today. So we... we meet here for lunch every solitary day. Sunday, we have a day off, but we meet here for lunch every day. This is not anything unusual.
This whole neighborhood was totally different because we had neighborhood little grocery stores that we would go on.
Lots of grocery stores.
Mm-hmm. Grocery stores. And
it was families that lived in these houses, not galleries.
Exactly. They weren't galleries.
Our friends lived there.
Yeah.
My dad, he would talk to the people in the neighborhood on Canyon Road and tell them, no vendan sus casas. Don't sell. But little by little, for different reasons, people sold their homes, not realizing that once they sold it, they could never come back.
A lot of people that I grew up with actually have left New Mexico in general, just gone off. I mean, some of my best friends live in California right now, it's actually pretty.
Is it because
sad.
Of jobs and school?
Yeah, it's mainly because of jobs, I think.
The jobs aren't here for the people, like our children, to sustain, to be able to live here and afford it here. When you think about your girls, would they be able to get a job here that would, they could afford a home even, or even afford the cost of living?
And you're still in your home working at a 9-to-5 job, and this houses are, there's a $2 million home here, a $5 million home across the street, and then they appraise your house, and some people can't even pay the taxes.
We've been doing the demolition and excavating and recycling. My father started this business in 1929. Today we're taking down a wall that's probably been here 100 years already or so. There are buildings that maybe shouldn't be demolished, but I can't make that call. I'm not the only company that does this, so somebody else may come in and demolish it. In Santa Fe and even in this country, you know, you can't stop people from coming to Santa Fe, but you can sure try and help the people that are already here.
Sentaditos bajo ese portal, y no más en cuanto llego, casi siempre me dicen así: llega, llega, hijito.
I grew up in a house right behind the school for the deaf on Oñate Place.
Oñate Place.
Franklin.
Catherine Avenue.
Mercer.
Camino Sierra Vista.
Minita.
Hickox.
Cortez.
Salazar.
Alicia.
Pauline.
San Dantel.
Eric Street.
Camino Aire.
Baca Street.
West Manhattan.
Agua.
Dunlap.
Don Juan.
Alameda.
The school for the deaf had a dairy that went all the way to Baca Street. Rail cars stopped to pick up milk. We'd pray the rosary in the evening just before bed, and we could feel the train. There were so many kids in the neighborhood. The Sanchez family had
12.
The Gonzalez had
8.
The Velardes had
6.
And next door, Mrs. Vela had
10.
We knew everybody, just about every familia. We'd buy candy at Luis Tiendita.
And now that's Tune Up Cafe?
Oh, sí, sí, pero no. Back in the day, it was just Luis. My godmother would give me money, and I'd buy candy for everyone. Orange peanuts made out of marshmallow. Yum!
Ugh.
Right behind our house was the Acequia Madre. And on the other side, the Acequia was a school for the deaf. The school had the best apple orchard. There was no St. Francis Drive back then, so that orchard was big. When they started building St. Francis Drive, us kids were furious.
Say it.
Assholes. They took away our playground. They took away our neighborhood friends, too. During the construction, they stacked those canutes right next to the railroad track.
Canutes are culverts?
Sí, mijito. Oh. Big ones. When the construction crew left for the day, you'd get 20 kids in there. I was the leader because I had the biggest mouth. Only the big kids in the pipe. Lean into it like this. And then that culvert would start to rock. Back and forth and back and forth. And then the culvert would start to roll. Faster and faster and faster. We'd be bouncing around inside, never giving up. We'd come out all bruised. And in the morning, the construction guys would cuss, finding another canute in the arroyo. They'd look at us. We didn't look big enough to cause that much trouble.
All bruised? Mom, you're still a rabble-rouser.
In 1963, agents working on behalf of the St. Francis Drive project began contacting homeowners whose houses were located on its proposed path. It was intended to relieve traffic congestion in the downtown area. The northern section was set to run from the National Cemetery to Sierra Vista. Hundreds of homes would be cleared away.
These were families, Hito, that lived humbly and were left with nowhere to go.
You know, Mama, this reminds me of a story that I've heard from my suegro and his family. You know, your compadre Manny.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, her name is Eva. She raised her 8 children in Santa Fe and helped build a home for them. That St. Francis Drive highway cut through the fields in front of their home and impacted the families, not just theirs, families like the Gonzalez family, Campos, Bransford, Valdez's, all no longer there. But today, of the 8 children, 3 are lucky to remain in that home. None of the others live anywhere near the barrio in which they grew up. 2 siblings now live in the Belmont neighborhood area and another on Airport Road. But all of Eva's descendants know that the house on St. Francis Drive is a safe and welcoming place, and it always will be home, in spite of the busy 6-lane highway that's just a few short feet away. But that house, it still stands strong, just like she did when that highway first pushed through. A pesar que ya no está con nosotros, su memoria permanece en esta casa, en su barrio, en los corazones de todos que la conocieron. Although she is now gone, her memory remains in that home, in her barrio, and in the hearts of everyone that knew Eva. And sabes que, mama, you're right. They were assholes.
Thank you.
$1.99. Out of two.
Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
How's the old man?
He's doing great. Thank you for asking. I grew up every morning drinking coffee with my grandfather. So it was an experience that I remember to this day, always being part of the morning ritual of sharing it with him. My grandfather, Orlando, would get up about 6 o'clock in the mornings and you know, make himself breakfast.
In your father's heart, and hearing me. Bless us, O Lord, in these great gifts. Which are about to receive of thy bounty. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
And so I'd sit there with him just before he opened the store. And then I'd come open the store and warn it. How's it going?
Good, how are you?
Good, thank you. The reason this place is special to me is it's going on 72 years. My grandfather and my father started it. My grandfather ran the store for about 30 plus years. Then my father ran the store. And then now me and my siblings, eight of us, I keep the store going. We alternate every 8 days. So it's part of the family. It is the family. What diminished the neighborhood stores was when the 7-Elevens came around. And they offered liquor and they offered gasoline. And so I think that's what slowly but surely, that was the demise of a neighborhood grocery store. This one survived for what reasons? I don't know. It's just.
Why do you think it survived?
The love that my grandfather had for it, my father had for it, and we have for it, the children. You know, it's just, you can't see it ever closing, so. It doesn't close. It's always felt it's a part of us. It's an extension of, you know, I don't know, anything takes work, but yeah, you definitely, you know, gotta have the love for the business, the customers. I mean, that's what makes this store. Where are you from?
I just bought a house down the street there. So.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
So. The one right at the top of Don Miguel?
We're Santa Fe.
Yeah, but we. I grew up here, born and raised here.
Oh,
cool. Went to St. Mike's.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, and he did too.
Welcome back.
Yeah, she lives in San Francisco now.
Cool.
Yeah. So I'll rent it out for the time being.
Short-term rentals and stuff, or?
I want to find a long-term tenant.
Are you?
Hopefully.
Welcome back.
Nice to meet you.
Likewise.
See you
again. Bye. Yeah. Good luck on your rental, but it'll happen quick.
Yeah.
Bienvenido since 1946, Johnny's Cash Store. El que tiene tienda, que la tienda, sino que la venda.
Presencia de un ser desconocido. Te vi llegar y sentí lo que nunca jamás había sentido. Te quise amar y tu amor no era fuego, no era lumbre. Las distancias apartan las ciudades destruyen las costumbres. Te dije adiós y pediste que nunca te olvidara. Te dije adiós. Y sentí de tu amor otra vez la fuerza extraña. Y mi alma completa se me cubrió de hielo y mi cuerpo entero se me cubrió de frío y estuve a punto de cambiar tu mundo, de cambiar tu mundo por el mundo mío.
It was a beautiful morning. The sun was rising. The birds were chirping. The doves were cooing. The chipmunks were chattering. It was so beautiful, so good. Even just to look at. Old Coyote is awakened by the sound of his growling empty stomach. Coyote wakes up and decides to go on a hunt for his morning meal. He travels through the arroyos of chamisa and yucca and juniper, searching for signs of animal life, searching and stalking for his prey. But Coyote cannot find any tracks. There's no bear tracks, no mountain lion tracks, none of the tracks of his friends that he used to play with in Santa Fe. There's no antelope tracks, there's no weasel tracks. Coyote searches and searches, but alas, all he can find is dog poop. Coyote says, "Ah, dog poop. I must be getting close to Santa Fe. This gives me an idea. I'm gonna check on the old borrego farm. Yeah, I'll check on his sheep too. And who knows, maybe I'll have lamb chops for lunch." So Coyote continues towards Santa Fe. When he gets to the edge of town, his eyes widen and his jaw drops. Oh, Santa Fe, everything has changed. He looks at the street sign, Old Santa Fe Trail. Old Santa Fe Trail? There's nothing old about it anymore. Coyote looks below his paws and the pavement is paved over the once dusty trail with a shiny black asphalt. Coyote continues down the road, and when he gets to Canyon Road, he doesn't recognize any of the familiar homes and farms that he used to visit. No, to his left and to his right, row upon row of fine art galleries. Coyote continues down the road, and when he gets to where the old borrego house was, he's so surprised to find that it's been converted into a fancy fine dining restaurant. Coyote, being the opportunist that he is, decides to go to the back of the building and dumpster dive. Maybe he'll find some lunch. As he's looking through the garbage bag, it smells terrible, pew! He's digging through the garbage and pulls out a paper menu, and it reads, "Lobster enchiladas with red chili chutney and a roasted corn aioli? Oh, hell no! They're not even making New Mexican food right anymore. I've had it with Santa Fe. I've had it with these people. I'm gone." And just like that, Coyote left town. He walked all day and all night until he came to the roots of an enormous cottonwood tree. He made a little nest and fell asleep that night as the moon was high and the tall grass swayed.
Coyote slept so peacefully, dreaming of little bunny rabbits with red chili lathered all over their bodies, wrapped up inside little corn tortillas, with their little bunny ears poking out one end of the taquito. He was sleeping so good until suddenly Coyote is awakened with a startling bewilderment. A chainsaw rips into the trunk of the enormous cottonwood tree. Ay, 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 what is the meaning of this? Coyote looks up, and a young man peeks his head out from the other side of the cottonwood tree. Oh, hello, Coyote. I didn't see you sleeping there. I'm so sorry to wake you. But to be honest, Coyote, you're trespassing on our land. This is reservation land. Yeah. Coyote looks around. He orients himself to where he's at. And realizes, sure enough, he's on the res. Oh, I'm so sorry. You see, I left Santa Fe in a hurry. I just don't feel like I belong there anymore. Everything's changed, even the food. I'm just looking for a new home. The young man says, Coyote, you can't live here. I'm sorry, but if you remember correctly, our people used to live in Santa Fe. We were the stewards of this land. And through acts of war and genocide, we were displaced. And now we live here on the reservation, and we just want peace and quiet. Coyote thought about it. He said, you know what? You're right. I don't want to live here. I don't want to be here. I don't want to be a trespasser like them in Santa Fe. The young man stopped Coyote and said, you know, you can't live here, Coyote, because you see, later on today, we're installing a brand new cell phone tower right here where you're standing. Yeah, Coyote, think about it. Our students need to stay current with the most advanced technology. And the casino needs Wi-Fi, right? Coyote? Coyote? The young man scans the horizon looking for a coyote and sees him running for the hills as fast as he can. Coyote! Wait! Coyote! Where will you go? Where will you go without a place to call home?
The city has been listening to one side of the argument for a very long time, and folks who, you know, work for a living, work multiple jobs, have kids, have been really left out of that equation.
Buying a piece of land in Santa Fe is out of the question for me and for you and for you. And for it. Ain't no way we can afford that.
A lot of our friends that live here live in homes that like don't have any running water. Like third world country with the technically, you know, one of the cities that is considered the richest city in New Mexico.
I've been in this apartment for 4.5 years. I would like to move from here because this apartment complex has a lot of problems. Roach infested, and then they go up on the rent every year, $25 a month. The washing machines don't work, and they just have a lot of problems.
If I continue what I'm doing right now, I'm gonna be an old lady living in poverty.
Actually, I live in Albuquerque now, and I commute. The price of living kind of pushes out of Santa Fe a bit. I'm trying to move back in now.
It's becoming a little more white. And that's being half white, that's hard to say.
You would hope that the city would really care about the people who
run it, you know? Like, we're the workers, and we run the restaurants and the bars and the hair and, you know, the local stores, the local scene, you know? And it's kind of crappy to think that, you know, everyone's struggling really hard right now, it seems like, to keep a roof over their heads.
I remember my place as a woman amongst my tribe. And I remember I don't have much of a voice there. I need change. I want to leave. But where and when?
What I've been doing here at Little Globe is, it's very important to me. It helps me release this tension I feel inside. Because my mom and I moved around a lot, from Tizuki to Santa Fe and then all around Santa Fe, she helped me a lot by helping me understand that home is more of a feeling than a place. A part of this displacement in Santa Fe and, you know, filming it, it's bringing up a lot of issues for myself in terms of getting it together, you know, what can I do to help myself and help my community?
There's only one person I can think of for answers. Navitete, my grandpa.
August 12th, Paul interview, take one.
Let's see. What would you say to me, teach me about how I should navigate as I grow up and try to live in this community?
Living in Santa Fe is, you know, it's a good thing. Here in this world, whether you want to call it the white world or the Western world or Santa Fe or whatever you want to call it, I'd like to see sooner or later one of you, you know, really move out and be able to afford your own home, get educated, get a good job, and afford your own home. You know, you could go move to Albuquerque. You know, you could make your own home outside your parents' home. That's what I'm saying. Very, very, it's difficult for Indian people to do that. That's what I'd like to see.
So strange, when he was describing the things he wants to see for me, is what I see in my mother. She has her own house. She has a happy home. Often I feel I am trapped between two worlds, the city life or the res life. I am still unsatisfied with how I am going to get there, to be stable as an adult in Santa Fe.
My life has always been about moving, seeking opportunity. I've never been the first person here. I'm always a visitor.
Pittsburgh will always be home, place of my birth, city that shaped and molded me during my transformative years.
Before Santa Fe, there were artists in residences in Roswell, Pittsburgh, Portland. Before that, I lived in Shanghai, Hong Kong, Baton Rouge. And before me, there was Taiwan. My mom came from Taipei. My dad came from Taichung.
I grew up around a lot of family. I've taken my children away from their grandparents, cousins, aunts, and uncles.
I never tasted my grandmother's food. She came to live with us. My mom cooked sambeji, 3-cup chicken. My grandmother complained it wasn't cooked long enough. She chewed and chewed, spit the bones out. She made a little pile on the table.
I left Pittsburgh in 2012 to move to New Mexico. I envisioned a new start for me and my children. Little did I know that that new life would be devoid of the Black community.
Could Santa Fe be a home for my daughter and me? We heard that Santa Fe either takes you in or spits you out.
A brown person with no Spanish name, no indigenous roots, no connection, no job prospects, no family.
I made a community of artists and writers, mothers, teachers, transplants. Year by year, Santa Fe opened its arms.
It took some time, but I've developed some close friendships. I'm comfortable here now. And I don't worry about the same things I would back in Pittsburgh. I've only been stopped once for using my cell phone while driving and was let off with a warning.
I've cooked red chili enchiladas for family and friends with a recipe from the internet. How does it have the taste of home when my ama is not from here?
Grilled chicken, collard greens, candy yams, and sweet potato pie. Each bite invites a memory. As a parent, I prepare these dishes for my kids now, hoping that it will connect them to the past, to memory, to home.
I am just the third generation of women folk in my family to be free to choose where to call home. I migrated from New York City to the Southwest. I planted myself here because it felt like there was room for me to grow. The places I lived before, Harlem, Park Slope, Brooklyn, Lower East Side, Manhattan, have long been gentrified, and I do not want to go back there. I don't come from an experience of displacement like my ancestors did, but one of placement. I chose Santa Fe. My roots here aren't deep, but my heart chose Santa Fe.
Born here, yet I don't belong. I share the feeling of being an inmigrante, even though I'm not actually one. We had come to Santa Fe because it was so hard for my family to make a living in Mexico. And then, when I turned 10, my father was deported. My mother, brother, sister, and I are all citizens. But the whole family moved back to Mexico to stay together. But educational opportunities are hard to come by in my hometown. So 2.5 years ago, I decided to come back here again, this time on my own. I left everything I had just to follow my dreams. Porque todos tenemos derecho a soñar. It hasn't been easy. But luckily, my dad taught me how to build a tough skin. If you fall from that horse, you get up, climb back up, and everything will be fine.
Teacher sees a lot, and schools reflect changes that happen in the community. I began my career at Connie Elementary. The students were from families from a variety of our town's residents, Native Hispanics, immigrants, some Anglos, and Native American kids. In my early years there, I taught the grandchildren of a former East Side neighbor. This man and his family had lived on a sequía madre for generations. And so I was baffled to hear that his grandchildren were now living in public housing. I discovered that a family member of that man had gotten into trouble with the law and needed legal representation. He approached his next door neighbor, an Anglo attorney. He told the attorney that while he didn't have money to pay him, he would give him a small piece of his property as payment. The attorney agreed and drew up the documents. Unable to read or write, the man signed the papers with an X. The attorney thanked him and left. Shortly thereafter, the man and his family were given notice that they had to leave their home, a house and property that had been in their family for generations. I was shocked and saddened to hear of this tragic loss. Its effects still felt generations, years later. Unfortunately, this was a common story for many Hispanics. In my final years, I transferred to Ramirez Thomas Elementary School on the south side with a majority immigrant students population. Their lives were hard, but their hardworking parents were so supportive and saw education as the key for a better life for their kids.
Something to say, you're looking at the world when you look at the camera.
I'm from playing with mud, running barefoot, and bathing in the river. I'm from having to build a tough skin.
To me, home means like not only a place that you can stop and rest, but it's also a place that's always in motion.
It tastes sweet, but bitter at the same time.
It feels warm from an emotional point of view, but it's always cold in our house. My family and friends make me feel like I belong.
I was born in Santa Fe. It's the place where I need to be in order to succeed in my future.
If home really is a safe place to thrive, then why aren't I thriving? If home is a place to be yourself, then why do I not feel like myself? If home is a place that is accepting, then why don't I feel accepted?
I don't exactly feel like part of Santa Fe. It feels more like a business transaction than a community. I use the services you're providing and I pay the bills, and that's like the end of the whole situation. I don't know what I can provide for the community, and the community doesn't know what I need.
It has a lot of flaws, and it will create divisions between people. I think we can start with just a lower cost of living in general. I think that would, you know, help a million times over if people were able to just, you know, live their lives without having to worry about where their next meal will come from or if they're going to have a roof over their head.
I truly believe that a community should involve every person. It should integrate everyone that lives in it.
My community kind of provides a place where I can learn, and it's kind of given me a lot of learning experiences that I hope to be able to bring back and make the city a better place.
What makes me feel like I belong here is, well, not only that I've lived here my entire life, but it just feels like it fits, like a shoe, like if the shoe fits.
You want to add anything else?
No.
I live in a part of Santa Fe called the South Side. You walk down the street and you see people who are having trouble. We used to live in an apartment, but now we're renting a house. Sometimes there's not enough money for bills.
My pa shovels dirt the same color as his skin. He's an apartment maintenance man in Oklahoma, and I remember thinking, wow, there's nothing my dad can't do. But he can't teach his 9-year-old daughter how to be an American girl. I am 22 now, and Santa Fe feels like a home made out of asterisks, a house built on doubt. I have been here for 4 years now, and I tell myself that I'm comfortable in my skin, convince myself that belonging and I fit into the same sentence. So why do I still hide my tired tongue? ¿Por qué me da ansia hablar español en esta ciudad? Back home, my mamá would consider me a success, proud and happy for what I've accomplished. A good job in a busy part of town, graduating with a bachelor's degree, debt-free, doing well. So why do I feel shame when the landlord tells me we don't have the space for you? You aren't white we are looking for. My boss tells me about a house she just bought. While I've been denied a credit card 4 times, denied housing for not having credit, and denied a chance for being too young.
In the summer of 2018, I both graduated from college and went through a breakup. I had no money and was attempting to start a career in art. I really wanted to do everything I could to stay in Santa Fe. An apartment at San Miguel Court was all that I could afford. But I had a bad feeling about it from the start. Staying there began to slowly stress me out, whether it was from the infestation of bed bugs or always feeling alert and paranoid about my surroundings. Once, while trying to paint, I could hear my neighbors arguing and yelling at one another, and then yelling as if someone had just been stabbed. Another time, I could hear someone being arrested right outside my front door. I could hear the sound of them being tased, and then them scream. I could hear their body hit the front door. I hid behind my bedroom door to try to calm myself from the ensuing panic attack. Life at the apartment complex became more adverse with each day.
Throughout most of Santa Fe, it's not too bad, but there are pockets of people who are in really bad situations. I chose to live in my truck. It was a conscious decision that I felt happy about. I could easily say that a good portion of the people who live in the middle of town, a good portion of them didn't have a choice. Something didn't work out for them. Trust me, when something doesn't work out, it's not fun. Some people have harder disadvantages, and that makes them more desperate. What if they really need that $20 that you have in your pocket? But they don't know how to ask you because their situation is so stressful that they don't even know how to function in society anymore, and they're trying to cope with it with whatever stresses are going on. When you're only working seasonal jobs, or you can only work so much because of other restrictions, like, say, trying to go to school or trying to take care of other people, missing a day of work can mean that you don't eat for 2 days. And, like, I've gone through that.
The area that I was from was Hillside Street. The whole area has been bought out, so we don't really go up there anymore. There's a few of the old families that still live up there, very few. Well, where did everybody go? Well, they had to go somewhere. They moved out. They had to move out because everybody else was moving in. I remember moving quite a bit, you know, from small apartment to small apartment, and it was tough. I could remember a lot of times my mom sitting down on the couch, her head in her hands, just not knowing what she was going to do, you know, for the next day, you know, just for the next day.
Within the next, you know, 20, 25 years, our people might not be able to afford the land that they've lived on for the last 300-400 years.
They literally dug up our sacred kivas for something as minuscule as a parking garage.
There's 6,000 vacant homes in this town, in a town that needs 6,000 homes.
I think now the tension is building and building and building. It's not just about Texans or Californians or whatever they think of it as. It's really a growing gap.
So what are we going to do? You know, we're going to fight.
We don't have a choice.
If our people have to choice,
it just doesn't feel right. I grew up and played here, and I would like to see that for other generations. I love it here, and I will always love it here. No matter how many changes it's undergone, I will always find a true sense of being here in Santa Fe.
Perdida por ahí seré core.
y si llego a vivir a viejito, esto les digo, señores, que el destino es de piedra de sangre. Y a pesar de mis dolores, no me dejaré. Y es santa la fe, aunque nos quede cada vez menos. Sabrán que ya siguen creciendo en lo profundo raíces, y al acabarse el dinero, al acabarse los países, we will still be here to build by earth and tears la Villa Real de los Santafesinos.
In my family, I was always the one who was going to break the chain. Be the first to go to college, the first to have a real career. Since I was small, I have always felt that pressure. I can still hear my abuelita telling me, "Tú no seas como el montón, mija." I share the dream too. I want to be successful. It has been a long journey, with ups and downs, and I have fallen so many times that I have lost count. But yet, each time, I have managed to stand back up. I want Santa Fe to focus on providing more support for students like me. I want Santa Fe to tell me that I can count on it, que yo pertenezco aquí, that I belong.
I have seen generations of students like Sabina leave Santa Fe. I want students to know that there is a future for them here. I want Santa Fe to have a place where we can hear children playing and we know our neighbors.
After 7 years of resisting and resenting, I finally made my peace with Santa Fe. Raising my children in a place that was not my home, but most certainly would be theirs.
With my community of artists and writers, we turned the city into a living book. We wrote poetry with the people here and stenciled the poems all over the city. Am I the one gentrifying Santa Fe, not with my money, but with my ideas of art and my middle-class education? At some point, I might not afford to live here also.
I want this place to be somewhere where everyone can afford to live. Somewhere where everyone belongs. Not in a I belong here and you don't kind of way, but in a I feel loved and welcomed in this place kind of way.
One of our neighbors was working on this beautiful RV truck. And you know, it's tiny, it's from the late 60s, early 70s. And we bought it on the very last day of our renter's agreement. And it was ours after that. Home is where you are happy and comfortable. For me, I believe home is wherever I happen to be in the moment, so long as I have my dog or any of my furry ones beside me and my boyfriend in good spirits beside me as well.
To belong to a place,
you have to be willing to pull back the layers.
To belong to a place, you have to be willing to learn the oldest names for the mountains, the streams, and the trails.
To belong to a place, you have to listen to the stories of your neighbors.
The stories of the young and the old.
To belong to this place, you have to feel the depth of its voices, songs, and dances.
You have to stand in the shoes of others in this town, those without a roof over their head or without full bellies.
I chose this place where I can take long walks, spread my arms to fingertips, close my eyes, and walk for as long as I dare. Starlings lift from the bushes, three, then six, then four. They keep coming, wings and wind. I need only lift my head a little bit to fill my eyes with sky.
La Villa Real de la Santa Fe de San Francisco de Asís.
Ogapogé.
Santa Fe, in my dreams, we are in love. Because in my dreams, you love me for who I am.
Cuando el sueño se hace real, así voy a saber que pertenezco, reconociendo también mi querencia en este lugar.
This is how I know I will belong, when the place that prides itself on being the city different allows for different types of people with different backgrounds to call this town home.
Things change, and they're going to change, and change can be really, really good. But often this change has happened in ways that's left people behind. Why is it that we have these structures that have left some of us behind? It changes the story from, oh, it's never going to be the way it was, and we're always trying really hard to go back in a direction that you can't go. Well, what's important back there? What is it that we feel that we're missing, and how do we bring that with us? And how do we do it in a way that doesn't require me to say, well, I've been here forever, and you haven't been here for very long, and so you can't understand me, and I can't understand you, and I don't want to work with you. How do we find a space where we can meet? And how do we find a space where we can say, oh yeah, we're both missing a sense of it being safe to be where you're from. We have work to do to make our lives close and intimate and integrated and community-oriented. And that's been a comfort, because it makes it a human story, not a Hispanic story, not a displaced person story, not a new person story, just a story.